your childhood, was it farm, small town? What was the area like where you grew up?
It was mostly smaller town. I mean, it was connected to Chicago, the suburbs, but the people were more or less in this atmosphere of small towns. You knew everybody in the area.
You know, a kid in the summers at that age, in that era, what would you do for fun? I mean, in that area?
Well, as younger kids, we'd play cowboys and Indians. That was the big thing those days. We'd be climbing over roofs, over garage roofs and that type, and we'd even get these Indian cigars, if you remember those days. And I remember trying one. I got so sick from smoking that one, I never smoked a cigarette or anything from that time on.
Did you go to the movies and see the great westerns? I mean, is that what sort of inspired the cowboys and Indians?
Probably. That probably helped it out, though. I mean, but it was just, everything was so, it was wide open. It wasn't too confined like it is right now, but you had a lot of open spaces and you could do things those days. Mm-hmm.
Did the Depression affect your family?
Yes, it did. My dad was out of work for quite a while, and we had to cut corners left and right. We didn't starve. They were able to keep the food and the clothing. And my mother, she was wonderful. She could make everything stitched and sewed and everything else. So it was a fantastic job that they both did, just to keep us, both my brother and myself, going. And we didn't have any luxuries, but we never were denied anything of substance.
Were you the kind of kid that liked school?
I didn't mind school too much. I in fact, I was taking college preparatory courses even then, which wasn't that popular as it is right now. A lot of them those days were taking shop and mechanics and that type of thing.
When you walk into a children's classroom, you have the full spectrum of kids. I mean, there's the loud kid, the quiet kid, the intelligent kid, the joker kid, you know, all those personalities. If we walked into your elementary school classroom, which kid were you?
Well, I was probably in between. I wasn't too loud, and I wasn't too boisterous or too quiet. I was always looking to get into some kind of trouble, probably, but nothing seriously. I did not. Those days, they our thoughts weren't on something where you were going to be malicious or anything like that. It was fun stuff more than anything.
When you look back on your childhood, did you like your childhood? Because the Depression was a hard time.
It was a hard time.
But did, when you look back on it, did you like it?
Yes, I did. It was a wonderful time.
Why was that?
I don't know. I guess you shared a lot of things with other people, and everybody was closer to each other. You mixed with the groups, and you tried to help everybody out. And I think it was just a general overall feeling of associated with people that needed help. Well, whether I was going to be called up or not, I assume I was, but I didn't want to wait. I wanted to get in and see what I could do.
Why did you feel like that?
I don't know. Probably, I guess you could call it patriotism. I don't know. Who knows? But in those days, everybody wanted to do well for their country, and I wanted to get into the branch that I wanted. Also, I didn't want necessarily get into the infantry or the Navy. I wanted to get into the Air Force. That was my ambition.
Why the Air Force?
Well, as a kid, I made dozens and dozens of model planes and everything. I knew quite a bit about the structure of planes and how they flew and the silhouettes. I think I knew every single German and Japanese and American silhouette of the fighter and bomber planes.
Had you ever been in an airplane?
No, never had been in a, not even to look at one.
Well, tell me what happened next then.
Well, I volunteered, and they put me off until it was about maybe about a month and a half or so until I graduated. And then they graduated, and this neighbor of mine, Johnny and I, he'd signed up for the infantry, and I signed up for the Air Corps. And that morning, I remember that he came over and we got together. We're walking down the street. We're saying goodbye to our parents, arm in arm with Johnny, and I didn't see him again for another 4 years.
And so off you marched. What happened after that?
Well, we got into the recruiting office, and actually they put you through physicals and mental, every kind of test. And then they sent us, I think they sent us to Fort Sheridan, I think it was, one of the other ones closer by, just to get settled in. And then from there, they sent me to Keysersville, Mississippi. And they really almost screwed me in the sense that I signed up for the Air Force. I wanted to fly. And they sent me to Keysersville to be a mechanic. So I got down there, and I was in mechanics for about a month and a half. And I said, this is not for me. I wanted to get to fly. So I went to see the CO, and I explained my situation to him. And he was pretty decent about it. And I said, I definitely signed up for the flying end of it, not for the mechanic end of it. He said, well, if you have any papers to that effect, bring them forth and we'll take care of it. I said, well, I got them at home and I get them. So I called my folks and they sent me the proper papers and I showed it to them. And within 3 days, they sent me out to Cookeville, Tennessee, University of Kentucky. In Tennessee, where we spent more or less a cadet training at that location.
Talk about the cadet training. What was that like?
Oh boy, that was tough. That was really tough. They try to wash you out, really. I mean, that was, I don't mean purposely, but I mean, they made it tough so that if you were maybe on the fringe of wanting to do it or maybe not too enthused about it, you'd wash yourself out.
Because was there a lot of competition then to become a pilot?
Oh yeah, quite a bit.
And so did you survive the cadet training?
Yeah, just barely, because this one day I'll never forget, the girls at Cookeville, Tennessee Polytechnic Institute, and the girls there would always serve breakfast, lunch, and supper. And this one time I made a date with one of the servers there, and you weren't supposed to do that. And so I met her out in the triangle that later on that night, and we were sitting there smooching on a bench, and who comes up with a flashlight in my face? I said, get that damn flashlight out of my face. And here it was, the CO was walking around and he caught us. So he caught me, he said, okay. He said, you're up for court-martial. So I went back to my room and I waited about 3 days, and finally the cadets actually did the court-martialing, or not court-martialing, but the judgment. And I was able to convince them that it was a one-shot deal and it wouldn't happen again. But I got about 27 tours, walking tours. That's walking around in a big long square and with a parachute in the back, and you keep on flipping and hitting your butt and your legs, you end up with blisters on them.
So that was the discipline.
That was the discipline.
And so did you move on to the next phase after that then?
Yes, well, from there we had about 6 or 8 hours of flying time at the at the hills of Tennessee there. And they were really hills, believe me. And from there, then...
Let me ask you, so you're finally getting into an airplane.
Yes, the first time.
What did you think? You finally got in an airplane.
It was very, very thrilling. And I almost crashed the damn thing up the first time. instead of applying the rudders, I was applying the brakes as I was going down the runway. And the instructor told me, he says, get your feet off those damn brakes. It chewed me out good.
But you survived those first attempts at flying there.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. So what happened after that?
Well, then from there we went on to, they had too many pilots going through, too many students that wanted to be pilots. So they gave us a choice of bombardier, navigator, or gunner, or infantry. And they want nothing to do with the infantry. So I took a bombardier navigator courses. So then they sent me to a bombardier school in Deming, New Mexico.
Talk about the bombardier training. What was that like?
It was very, very tough. It was very strict. And they had a good washout rate, too. I mean, if you didn't really want it, you wouldn't last.
Did they train you on the Norden bomb site?
Yeah, trained in Norden bomb site.
Can you talk a little bit about that? Because that was a super secret project, wasn't it?
It was, I mean, so-called secret, but I mean, actually, the Germans probably had a dozen of them already that they got out of some of the planes they shot down from our, but it was probably more so the training on how to use the site and get enough of people that they could utilize the equipment more so than the actual unit itself. But it was pretty severe. They had us constantly working on procedures and malfunctions and everything else. We went to El Paso, Texas, and we got a crew together there. And we ended up with a full crew.
Was it 9 or 10 guys?
We had 10.
And do you kind of remember your impression of these guys? I mean, a bunch of young guys from all different parts of the country.
Well, I had to assimilate with them more so than anybody because being a bombardier, I was in charge of the gunners. So I got to know them fairly well. I mean, being an officer, you know, you can't mix too much with your enlisted men, but I tried as much as possible because I figured we were going to be up there and live and die up there. We might as well try to get along as well as possible. But I did like my pilot and my co-pilot.
Who was your pilot?
My pilot was Greenstreet. His last name was Greenstreet. And he just died about 6 or 7 years ago. Wonderful pilot, fantastic pilot. Earl Greenstreet was his name. My memory is not that great.
when all 10 of you are flying up there in the airplane, was it really GI, yes sir, no sir? How did you all talk to each other and relate?
No, it was kind of informal. I mean, we didn't have the yes sirs or no sirs. I mean, on the ground you might have because you had no choice, but up in the air it was just air talk more than anything. And we got to be a very cohesive crew because we knew we were going over there and we knew we had to fight as a unit and try to stay together and survive.
During that crew training, I guess it was known as phase training, where you're all training together, was there anything unusual happened, any mishaps, anything that stands out in your mind regarding that time period of time?
Well, we did, we lost a night flight out of Texas, we lost one of our engines and it started on fire. And so my pilot said, well, as much as I would like to bring it back, I can't. He said, we're going to have to let it go down. He said, everybody hit the silk. So we bailed out. And all the way down, the only thing I could think of is, I'm going to land in a cactus. I know I'm going to land in a cactus. But fortunately, at the end, I landed in the desert out there. It didn't have any trouble.
Did everybody land safely?
Yes, everybody made out safe.
Yeah. Did you see the plane go down?
I saw it going. I didn't see it actually crash, so.
That's certainly memorable. Anything else come to mind as far as that phase training period?
No, it was a fairly short. It wasn't too long a training period, really. I mean, considering what we were going to get into later on.
How old are you at this point?
I was 18. Well, from there we went to Lincoln, Nebraska. We got our plane, and we were supposed to fly over to Europe with the plane, which we eventually did.
Talk about the journey over there, because that's a whole lot of Atlantic Ocean to fly over. What do you remember about that journey?
I remember that we were told that if we had to go down in the drink, that you have about 3 minutes to get out, otherwise you're going to die of hypothermia because of cold water and all that. So when we were flying over there, I was taking some shots, some sun and moon star shots, just to keep myself abreast of where we were in case anything happened. But we made it over there without any problem. We were lucky. My buddy that was on a plane just back of us, he had a crash in the ocean, but he survived. But I mean, they came down. They lost quite a few coming down like that.
Did you stop in Iceland?
Yes. Yeah.
What was that? Must have been pretty different.
Greenland and Iceland, and I mean Reykjavik. I mean, you would land in there. The snow was plowed off of the runways, and it was so high that when you land, you're like in a tunnel. I mean, like in a runway with snow banked on both sides, above the height of your plane. And you know, before we went overseas, each one of our crew members took 10 fifths of whiskey with us. I don't drink, but my crew is the biggest drinking crew you ever met in your life. But anyway, each one of us took 10 fifths with us, and we put it under the floorboards of the plane and hit them. You know, well, I'm sure that the higher echelon knew that this was going on because there were too many people doing it. But anyway, we landed in, I think it was Reykjavik, and the snow was so high and coming down so constant that they said we had to keep one or two men out there all night long sweeping the snow off the wings so they wouldn't collapse. And so I got a hold of the crew chief out there, and I said, hey, I got a couple of bottles of whiskey here. It tells me that you got a couple of men here that would like to watch over that plane during the night. So sure enough, he said, I'd gladly take it, because they had no source of getting anything out there at all. They were snowed in just like we were snowed in.
And so they covered it rather than you guys.
That's right. We got some sleep, and then the next day or so, we were able to fly out of there. Yeah.
Talk about the arrival then in Europe, and where you went from there.
Well, I think I can't remember exactly where we landed in Europe. I think it was in Scotland somewhere, and I think it was 2 days at the base in Scotland. And we went to town, and we got to meet some of the local people and talk to them and so forth. And they seemed so strange at that time because we had never met anybody like that. But they were nice. But the women were so strange. I just got out of high school, and I was so naive. I didn't know what it was used for. So it was really a scary moment.
Do you remember the arrival at the base, or what your impressions were when you got there?
Well, it was just a small field. It didn't look very large. It had a lot of planes on the field, and it had a lot of farmland around there. It was wide open there, and it was built on a big farm. But how they were able to manufacture these airfields out there so fast, it's unbelievable.
What did you live in the base? What were the living conditions?
We had Quonset huts there, and they weren't too bad. They just that you couldn't get warm there. They furnished us coal, and the coal was, I forget where they said it came from, but I think it was coming up from somewhere in one of the islands out there. Because when you get it, you had a tough time getting that coal burning. And so we used to go over to the bomb dump and and get some of the rings that were around the bombs and cut it up because they had chemicals in it, and they started on fire, then that would start the coal on fire. But it was mostly coal and stone. I mean, it just, half of it wouldn't even burn.
And were there other crews in there with you?
There was another crew. There were two crews. There were four of us on the one side of the Quonset hut and four on the other side. And we got to know them very well.
When you got there, did the training period or checkout still, I mean, were you still training when you got there? Did they check you out?
They checked us out on a couple of flights around that area, and more or less to give us an idea, too, of what it looked like from the air. Fortunately, we had a real good checkpoint there because it was right near a Framlingham Castle, and this stream that came in from the coast there would point right to the castle, and the castle then would more or less point to our airfield. So it helped us many times coming back when it was so foggy that you couldn't see anything, but you spotted those landmarks and you were able to make it.
How many missions did you fly?
I have 28 missions.
And you certainly aren't going to remember all the missions, but there may be missions that stood out for you. Did you remember your first mission, just because you must have been anticipating it?
I don't know if I do or not. I remember more or less the third mission is the one that we were shot down with, but I mean, other than that, I don't remember too much of the first. I think the first one was, I don't know, something is exciting and all that, but I mean, we were probably too excited to even get scared, I think.
Well, tell me the story of the third mission.
Third mission, we were supposed to bomb a target called Heilbronn, Germany. And we left the base and we formed up over the coast and on our way to the target, and on our way there, just before the target, we got hit with flak, and it knocked out one of our engines. And my pilot was a fantastic pilot. I mean, he and the co-pilot were one of the best. And so he was able to feather the engine, and we were able to continue on our bomb run. And we dropped our bombs, and just right after the bombs were dropped, another engine got hit. And so we were starting to go down. We had to we were losing altitude. We were under control, but I mean, we were coasting down and back. So we lost our fighter protection and all that. And that's all I could think of, is getting hit with fighters after that. And we drifted down into a cloud bank. And while we were in that cloud bank, we tried to stay there as long as possible, because at least we could get rid of the fighters. Because just before we got into the cloud bank, a German fighter came and strafed us. And I thought we got hit with another engine, but it didn't. It might have hit it, but it didn't do any damage to it.
What's a fighter look like when it's coming in?
Like a bee, just like a big bumblebee, you know. But with red fires coming out of it.
Little blinking kind
yeah.
of.
Yeah.
And so you're in a cloud bank trying to get away so that the fighters don't spot you.
You're right. Yeah, because we figured once we go down below the cloud banks, we'll be sitting ducks down there. But we couldn't stay in it too much longer because we were starting to lose altitude, because we only had two good engines at that time. So we started throwing out different parcels of equipment out of the plane so that we could lighten it up a little bit. But we were going down, and we were under complete control. Complete control. My pilot was exceptionally good. And
now the engines are feathered, but there's no fire or anything like
no,
that?
No, one was smoking, but it wasn't on fire. I don't know why, but it was still smoking. And so we were going down. We finally got down, oh, maybe a couple of thousand feet, a little more than that, a little more than a couple of thousand feet. And he said, okay, we're going to have to bail out because we can't make it back. There's no way. So I used to stand in back of the pilot all the time on landing and takeoffs to call up the airspeed for him. And he said, you better get back into the radio room, he said, because we're going to have to crash land. He said, we won't be able to stay up here. It was too dangerous. So I went in the back, and we're waiting for him to ring the bailout bell, and nothing came. Finally, my co-pilot came running, charging through the bomb bay doors. He says, can't you hear the bell? Get the hell out of here. Well, evidently, the electrical system had been hit, and we couldn't hear the bells. I mean, it knocked out the system completely. So everybody started bailing out then, and it got my time to go. I looked down, I could see stumps of trees that were blown up and so forth. And I figured, oh, no way I'm going out, and this is too low. And Tom, my waist gunner, he went out just before me, and his chute didn't open because he was too low. So I was lucky I didn't try to do the same thing. But then, see, we made a pass, we made a round circle because of the fact that we were in a forest area from far as your eye could see, like the Black Forest almost over there. And so we made this circle, and we dropped our gunners off, and fortunately they landed right on the front lines. But as we made that turn to go back, trying to find a farm or someplace, an open space to crash land, because we were still losing altitude, not too fast, but I mean, a little bit as we were going along, there's no way we could make it back. But we were traveling back into German territory. So finally, my co-pilot said, well, we got to bring it down now, or no, we won't make it. So we brought it down into a small little town. This tiny little town, couldn't have been more than 50 people in it. And it was a farming town. And a lot of farms were in that area. And we came in, and he made a wheels up landing, and he's scraping along. And I said, boy, this thing, I had my feet up against the radar set in the radio room, waiting for the impact, you know. And it didn't come. I figured, what's wrong? And what had happened is that he made this beautiful landing, But as we get to the end of the spot that where he was coming in on, there was a dip. So it was like it kind of threw us up into the air again. So we got another maybe a couple hundred yards of flying distance, and then he came down, and then it really hit. And this radar unit came loose from the bulkhead that I had my feet up against and came barreling towards me. Unfortunately, I had my feet up against it, and I was able to deflect it up into the top of the plane. It hit me in the face and made me black and blue and knocked a tooth out. But it took the top of the plexiglass out of the radio room there. So when we landed, we finally came to a dead stop. I was able to climb right out of that big hole that was up there in the radio room. And I could hear, to this day, I can still hear the tanks of oxygen that were ruptured and were escaping. And I, with the one engine still smoking, I was afraid that it was going to ignite and blow up. So I kept on yelling, "Get the hell out of the plane. Get out of there. The thing's going to blow." But we didn't. We both got out of there. All four of us got out of there. And
that was one question I was going to ask was, who exactly was left on the plane?
The four of us were left on the plane.
So the pilot, co-pilot,
navigator, and myself.
So the four officers, the enlisted men, had bailed out.
Right.
Where did you land as far as, were you in German territory, Allies territory?
No, we were in German territory, maybe about, I'd say probably 15, 20 miles behind lines, I'd say, behind our front troop lines. And we headed, the reason I remember, I went back in 1998, I think it was, and I went and I tried to find this area, and it took me almost a week to find it, but I finally found it. I found the exact spot, not the plane wasn't there, but I found the spot because it had like it was a forest area by this farm, and it had a four-leaf clover signature on it, in front of it, you know, and that's how we found it. So my wife and I went back and we spotted it back.
So the four of you get out of the plane as soon as possible. What happened after that?
Well, we hid into the woods because we couldn't stand out there in the open because they were waiting for the local people or the military to try to get us. So we hid into the woods, and we kept in the woods almost all the entire time. And we traveled at night, and we holed up during the daytime.
Where were you going?
Well, we had had my compass with me, so we were just going west, hoping to get to somewhere where we would link up with some of our American troops somewhere along the line, hoping to get to a spot where we could meet them somewhere along the line.
Along the way, did you have any interaction with civilians?
Not civilians, but with the German troops, though, because they were all around us. They were looking for us for a while, but they gave it up because the weather was in January. It wasn't the nicest weather. And we were in an area, like I said, this wooded area. It went on for 100 miles. And by being in there, they couldn't keep that many troops in there. And plus the fact that the Americans, I think, were starting an offensive. And they were kind of keeping them off guard to a certain extent also.
This plane that went down, did it have nose art on the nose?
It had some on there, but not the complete one, but it was called Sweet and Lovely is what it was called. But it didn't have the nose art that the one that they have now that shows the Sweet and Lovely. You know, it just had a big blonde out there, you know, hanging out, just like you probably see most of them.
And so you're dodging German troops. You're trying to head towards the Allies' line. What happened? Take me through it. What happens?
Well, like I say, we were traveling at nighttime, and because you couldn't do it during the day, and they would spot us. Because at first that we could hear them, they were looking for us. They were searching for us. But then they gave that up, and so we were able to skirt a lot of those. And so we just traveled, like I say, at night. And kept out of view at all, hid during the day so no one could spot us.
Did you have any food?
We had our bailout kits, and they were gone about the second or third day. I mean, they completely gone. There's not too much in them, and there's just enough to keep you, from passing out. But
was anybody injured of the four of you?
No. The four of us. Just I was the only one. My face was black and blue with the big nose like this here, But about the fifth day, I'll never forget this. We came upon it. We were getting fairly close to our lines by that time because the Americans were shelling the Germans, and somewhere during one of the shellings, one of the American shells had killed a German rabbit. So my pilot and I, we got all our trench knives off and we cut up this rabbit. We ate it raw, and my pilot and my navigator wouldn't touch it. But we were so hungry. I used to go hunting all the time when I was back home. My folks used to make what they call Hasenpfeffer, which is a rabbit feast, and I won't eat them now though.
But it kept you alive,
and that was it. Yeah, just something that we needed the energy just to keep going. That's all.
How cold is it?
It wasn't too bad. It was cold. It was winter time, and it was in January, and it was cold. But we had our heavy flying suits on, and then, so therefore it wasn't too bad. We were able to. We didn't freeze. We were just uncomfortable more than anything.
Did you have weapons with you?
Oh yeah, we had our 45s and our trench knives. Yeah.
Had you discussed between the four of you what you would do if you did encounter some German troops?
We kind of knocked it around just for a couple of minutes, but more or less, my pilot was more of a he was more realistic than we were. In other words, he said we get surrounded by the German troops, we just give up. That's all. He said, don't try to do anything, Whereas myself, I wanted to hightail it out and see if I could get away. But he was a smart one. He was older, and he knew more about this.
So yeah, you're into your fifth day. You've had this rabbit. Where did it go from there?
Well, we kept on going for another couple of days, and all of a sudden we came upon a small stream, and it wasn't frozen. It was just slowly trickling down, and we could see a German soldier would be at one end over here, one here, and then maybe one farther down. They were like delayed action troops, I guess, because the other side of that stream was so-called American advance, not troops, but what would you call them, recons or something on that order. And they saw a Jeep over there, and we saw the Jeep over there, American Jeep, so we assumed that they were like a recon unit trying to find out, probe it, see what was in front of them, But there's no way that we could get across that stream without being shot at, because it was just too wide open. So I told my co-pilot, I said, you take the guy on the left, and I'm going to take this guy on the right here. But I said, we have to use our trench knives. You can't use our guns. So we went, and he took care of his, I took care of mine, and we went across the stream. And the only thing I could think of going across the stream was, here we're going to get shot by our own troops, because they don't know who we are. They could think that we were Germans, because we didn't have any uniforms on. It was just a flying equipment. We probably looked like a bunch of monsters coming across the field.
That kind of warfare with a face-to-face, man-to-man knife, I'm going to ask you, how difficult was that?
It wasn't nice, and I don't like to even talk about it too much now, because it's not a nice way to end somebody's life, but it was either that or else we were going to get it, And so it had to be done, and we did it. I wouldn't want to do it again. It's a bloody one.
And so because of that, were you able to get across that stream?
Yeah, we started across this little stream, and we got about two-thirds of the way through, and this little platoon sergeant that was over there with this Jeep, he hollered out to halt, you know. So we told him, hold it, we're Americans, we're pilots, shot down. And so he said, well, come forward. Well, we went forward, and we got to him, and he saw the, how we were dressed and everything. He said, well, get in the Jeep. So we jumped in the Jeep with a couple of his troops in there, and we started off. And just as we started off, the Germans started, they spotted, and they started shooting. And you could hear every once in a while, you hear a bing, bing, bing off the Jeep. So you knew that if they could have gotten us, they would have gladly taken care of us, too.
And so you made your way out of there. Where did you go?
They took us back to a control group where they had their maps and the different forward. I don't know what the infantry calls them anymore, but they took us over to their CP, I guess, would you call it, and we stayed there for. Maybe 4 or 5 hours, and then they took us in another couple of jeeps, and they took us back into a small little town probably no more than 50-60 people towards the French coast, the French area. And when we were in there, this is really something that I'll never forget, is that well, we were in there, it was on a Sunday, I remember that, and they had a mass going on, and I'm Catholic. So I said, well, I'd like to go to the Catholic mass. You know. So the guy said, yeah, well, go ahead, be my guest. So we went in there, and the church was no bigger than this room right here. In fact, this is larger than the room, of the main room of the church. And they start going through the ceremony. And because at that time, the Latin was the standard language for the Catholic masses, we all understood. We didn't understand their homilies or anything like that because it was in French. But I mean, everything else was in Latin, and we were able to follow just like we had followed back home.
It was like a little connection to home.
Yeah. Right, it did. I mean, it just, it was a strange feeling, you know.
Because it was familiar.
Yes, yeah. It was a good feeling.
You know, one thing I didn't ask about, when did you get something to eat?
We got some meat. We got back to the CP there when they took us back to the I forget what they called it. It's where they had the radios in that time. They didn't have the best of food. And I'll tell you one thing, I appreciate the infantry, believe me, because these guys were living in holes, foxholes that were frozen. Some had water even in it, you know. And the reason that we weren't freezing was because we had our heavy flying, because these poor guys, all they had was their wool suits and their wool coats, and they were freezing. I feel so sorry for them.
Well, take me through the rest of it. How did you get back?
Well, then they took us back from this little town. They took us to another one. I don't remember what that one was. And then they took us back to Paris. We made our way back into Paris. And we stayed there, about 4 or 5 days. And we had a good time in Paris. That was a fun time there, something that you didn't expect. The only thing I didn't like about Paris, the Parisians are wonderful people. The farmland and the outsiders are wonderful. But the Parisians themselves, to me, even during the war, they were no good. I mean, we were sitting in front of this cabaret with a couple of girls and having a drink, and these two guys walked by, it must have been about maybe 22, 24. Go home, Yank. And they had just liberated the town just a couple of weeks before that. You know, I mean, it was unbelievable.
I want to ask what you did to those two guys.
We were tempted to do something, but my buddy said, "Let them alone. We don't want to cause any trouble." And well, we had enough of trouble. We didn't want any more.
So you spent a few days in Paris there. Yeah. What happened after that?
Well, we spent about, I think it was about 3 or 4 days in Paris. We saw the sights. We went to the Eiffel Tower, Napoleon's tomb. I mean, that's the kind of stuff that I like to see too, because I never had a chance to see it. And so after going through and visually spotting these different places, about the fourth day, they finally said, "Well, you got to fly, I'm going to fly you back to your base now." So the next morning, we met at the airport, and they took me and flew us back to England, to our base.
Were the people at the base surprised to see you?
Yeah, they were very much surprised. Yeah.
Were your bunks still there?
My bunk was there. Everything was there except my clothes was all gone. My whiskey bottles that I had saved, because we were saving them for our 13th mission, because you always kept it for that one there, you know. And so whoever was taking care of the bunks or the billets when men were shot down, these guys always got the best of everything. So they stripped it clean.
With regard to the enlisted men of the crew who had bailed out, do you know what happened to them?
Yeah, we finally met them back in Paris. We got together in Paris, and we got together as a group again. And we flew back to England as a unit.
So, and I know there was the one crew member who had died in because the parachute didn't open. Did the other, was it five enlisted men? Had they evaded the Germans that like you had?
No, they had landed right on the American lines. I mean, as we made this big wide circle turn, they floated down into the American side, just inside the American lines. So they lucked out. But my navigator, he went when we got hit. The second time he got hit, he went berserk. He went nutty.
This was on another mission?
No, this is the same one. When we got hit over the target, he went buggy, and he was throwing maps all over the place. He lost it, you know. So I told my pilot that I'd like to give him a heading to take to go west, just to get us out of that area. And when we got back to England, he refused to fly again. So they took him off. They took him off our crew, and that's when I turned into a bombardier navigator then.
So, did you cover both functions then?
Sometimes I did. Sometimes I'd have just one. It depends on what the mission was.
Did everybody kind of understand that the navigator just couldn't go on any further, or what was the mood as far as towards him?
I don't think anybody had any animosity towards him or any ill feeling. I mean, we were still young yet, and a lot of these things that are taking place are, I don't know, you just take it for granted, and. We didn't have any ill feelings or anything like that.
Was there some sense too that you'd gone through all this and this was only the third mission?
Yeah, that kind of scared you. You know, you figured what's going to happen in the next one. Yeah.
Are there other missions? This certainly was a memorable mission. Were there other missions that stood out in your mind too? The things that happened thereafter?
The ones that really stood out in my mind is at the end we had two missions dropping food to the Dutch, and we only had the pilot, co-pilot, and myself and the tail gunner in the plane, and the rest of the plane was loaded with food. I mean, it was, you couldn't put another box of food in there. Your bomb bays were just loaded with them. And I remember they allowed us to fly over there, and they wouldn't shoot us as long as we didn't deviate from a course that they gave us.
So the war is still going on.
The Germans had control over parts of Holland and Denmark, and quite a large area. And the people were starving there because they were cut off. The American troops just cut the whole area off, and they kept on going. And so the Germans had no supply lines, no nothing. So we went over, and I think it was about 3 days in a row, we dropped tons and tons and tons of, I don't know how many thousand tons of food.
Could you see people on the ground?
Yes, because we came in at about 500 feet, and we were supposed to look for the big white cross where you dropped the supplies. Well, it got so bad that there were so many planes in the air, And finally, I told my pilot, I said, I'm just dropping the period. Let them find out where the stuff is. So I just jettisoned everything I had. And I even some of the boxes that came out of the plane landed in the dikes there. But that didn't stop them. As cold as it was, these people jumped in that water and they got it, because they were starving. They lost about 40,000 people in the starvation.
Could you actually see the people going for the food?
Yes, yes, I did see some of that. Not to the point where I could make out their features, you know, but I mean, I could see the bodies going towards it.
Was there particular satisfaction in those missions?
Oh, yeah, I figured, you know, instead of blowing something and killing somebody here, at least I'm saving somebody from starving and starvation, and nice to know that you're doing some good once in a while, so.
When you flew your final mission, did you know it was your final mission?
I had an idea. It was because of the final mission was where we went and we picked up prisoners of war.
Tell us about that.
Well, we flew into,
Was it Linz, Austria?
Linz, Austria, yes. Well, you must have had somebody else in there. You're right, I couldn't even think of it. And we flew in there and we landed. And we landed near a house about three times the size of these rooms here. And what they had these four columns of people marching in and out the other end. It was a delousing building. And they'd come in the building, filthy as hell, come out white as a ghost, you know, because it was just delousing, because they were all full of bugs and everything else. So they got in these big long lines, and you talk about poor people, how they can be degraded and all that. They had to go to the toilet, and they sit right down in front of you, you know, and they'd go, you know, and wipe their hands on the grass, you know, but I mean, this went on for miles. There weren't just maybe 100 feet. You're talking about a couple of miles of people strung out as far as they could go.
And who are these people?
Most of these were Belgian, French, and some English prisoners of war. And there weren't hardly any Americans at this particular time.
And what was your purpose in being there?
Well, I was a navigator on our plane.
Well, what I mean is, what were you trying to, were you transporting them somewhere?
Yes, you were transporting them back to Paris and Brussels and to England. And so we picked up this load, and they were jammed in the planes. They were just stacked in there like cord, you know. And as we're going down the runway, my pilot yelled at me. I'm standing right in back of them, which I usually am takeoff and landing. And he says, They've got the controls jammed up. He said, get them off the cables. Because those days, the planes were run by manual cables, not like electronic today. So I ran back into Bombay, and sure, these guys are hanging there, and they were holding onto the cables, which was understandable, because they didn't want to get knocked around, you know, knocked off their feet. So I got them off the cables and got back in back of Earl, my pilot. And just as we did, I saw we come into this end of the runway where there was a big fence, about an 8-foot fence. And I don't think we missed that fence by more than 1 foot. But so just all that time, all those years and all the combat missions and everything, and here you get killed trying to bring some prisoners back, you know. The Chowhound missions were probably maybe a week or 10 days before the war was over. The prisoner of war missions, the war was over at that particular time.
And so were you looking to heading home at some point?
Yeah, we were kind of looking forward to it, but you know, at that age, it's still excitement. I mean, we knew that we wanted to get back home, and we wanted to see our families, and we wanted to get with our loved ones. Plus, the war was going on in the Pacific, so we figured they sent us back we went back to Sioux Falls, South Dakota. They were going to train us in B-29s and but the war ended, so we didn't have to go over.
Talk a little bit about the how did you get from from Framlingham, from the base, to back to the U.S. Did you fly back?
We flew back, yeah, and we flew there and back. We were lucky because a lot of them had to take ships and boats back instead of flying back, but we were lucked out. We had our plane and we flew our plane straight back to the States.
Did you take anybody with you?
No. Just a crew.
And did you go the northern route?
Yes, went the northern route.
Was any superstition about flying over the Atlantic? This is, the last thing you want to do is go down on that mission.
You were sweating it out because you didn't know. You remember the flight over, and you remember how touchy it was, went a couple of times there, especially when you were up in the northern parts of the area. And you just didn't want to have anything happen now that you went through all this combat and everything and get killed by landing in the ocean someplace.
Do you remember what it was like finally landing in the U.S.?
It was fantastic. I still can feel the adrenaline in my body when I landed. And I'm not trying to be patriotic or anything like that, but I mean, it reminds you of some of the scenes you see in the movies where the guys say, "Thank God it's the USA again," and it was a wonderful feeling.
Now, when you did land on in the U.S., the war in the Pacific still going on.
Yes.
Did you get some leave where you could go home?
They gave us a month's leave when we got back. They had to because they were flying so many people back by that time, and so many people coming back from Europe. They just didn't have room for them in the different camps. So they gave us a month leave, and then after the month, we went back and they started training us.
Tell me about the homecoming. On the leave, did you go home?
Yeah.
What was that like?
Oh, it's unbelievable. Yeah, you have to experience it to describe it. You can't really describe it. It's something that you look forward to for so long, and you don't know if you're ever going to make it back again. And then you do, and you figure, boy, it wasn't that bad after all,
Tell me about actually going home. Did you burst through the front door, and there's Mom and Dad, or what was that?
Well, when I got home, and my folks lived in Cicero at the time, and our cousins lived in Berwyn. And so they were visiting them in Berwyn. So when I got home to Cicero, they weren't there. So this neighbor of ours told me where they were. So he took me in his car and drove me over to next town where they were. And they were sitting in the living room in their kitchen eating lunch. And when I was a kid, I was very finicky. I was spoiled. And I didn't eat meatloaf. I didn't like meatloaf. So we got over there and they had meatloaf. And my aunt says, "Oh, we'll get you something else, eat something." I said, "You give me that." I said, "I'll eat that. I love that stuff now." Because that was like gold compared to some of the food that we got over. We had terrible food over in England.
So they were glad to see you?
Oh, yeah. Really happy to it, yeah.
And so I think you mentioned, after the leave, you went back to train on B-29s.
Right.
What happened after that?
Well, they just started basics on the ground training on B-29s, but then it got to the point where they saw that it was going to be over there, so they kind of cut down the training period. We didn't get any flying time after that, then it was mostly ground preparation. And then the war ended, and they sent us all home.
When were you discharged? Or how much time passed?
It was 45. It was the latter part of 45, I remember.
Were you tempted at all to stay in the service?
I was, but I had enough of it for a while. I didn't want to. But I did stay in the reserve. I stayed in the flying reserve for about five years after that. I used to fly out of Chicago O'Hare Airport. At that time, that was their reserve headquarters there.
What was your occupation after the war?
I went to school. In fact, I just got out of school, high school, so I went back in college and got my degree in college.
And then what kind of work did you do after college?
I was an accountant. Uh-huh.
Were you proud of your time in service?
I was, yes.
Yeah, tell me, why was that?
I thought I was doing the right thing. I thought I was trying to eliminate the bad guys in the world and trying to make it decent for the rest of the world, trying to liberate people that were, like, I felt so sorry for the Polish nation. They got the rawest deal between Roosevelt and Churchill, the way they sold that country to Stalin. That just irritated me, and I wanted to rectify some of that.
And did you feel like you did your part?
I thought I did, but then, you know, once you got back to college, I mean, you're starting a new life all over again, and you forget three quarters of the things that you even did or what happened before that.
Was it sort of at that point, you're not looking back, you're looking forward, your whole life's in front of you?
Right. I think you're right there. I think you've had this one feature, now you want to jump to the next one. Let's see what that's going to do. And you're young yet. You're young, you know, you got a lot of life ahead of you, so you try it.